trusting that God is going to do, a lot of times we start thinking about all the things that can go wrong instead of thinking about all the things that can go right. Amen? Because when God is involved in it, it's going to go right. Amen? It may not go right in the timing that we want. It may not even go right in the way that we think it is going to go right. But when we make a personal invitation for God to be involved in the process of what it is that we're planning to do, then you have to operate fearlessly. You cannot be operating from a place of I don't know. Because if God knows, then we have to trust that God knows and be willing to step out in faith and do things that are significant, right? And that's what this message is about. So it's going to be in Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 19. So if y'all would please stand, and we will read that together. Let us read it. It says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And they replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. But what about you, he asked, who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for everything that you do for us, and we thank you for bringing us here to your house to praise you, to honor you, and to thank you for the many blessings that you have poured out upon us, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that you will always be the guiding force that leads us in all things that we do, Lord, and help us to have the confidence and faith in you that you can do amazing things, and that when we trust in you, we are able to accomplish what not even our own imaginations feel possible, Lord. And we pray that as today, as we receive your message, that you will open our hearts and minds and spirits so that we may be fertile soil. And Lord, we pray that you will plant that seed of truth in our hearts so that it may sprout forth, bringing much fruit. And we thank you for this church, and we thank you for everything that you do for us. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. And what did he tell Peter? He says in Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, he says, I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. You know, there are so many things that stand in our way of receiving God's blessings, and there are so many messages that are out there, right? There's a million messages that are out there that are vying for our attention. There are a million people that are out there trying to make to convince us and to have us to believe a certain way. And sometimes when we pay too much heed to all these contradictory messages, then God's message is lost in all the static. And when God's message is lost in the static, then we cannot step out in faith and accomplish what it is that God is calling us to accomplish. Because God is not calling us to only accomplish material things. He's asking us to accomplish spiritual things. And if we're going to accomplish those spiritual challenges that he has laid for us, we must adopt that spiritual mindset. And we cannot be living in the flesh. You know, when I was preparing for this passage, it reminded me, during World War II, when the United States stormed the beaches of Normandy. And, you know, I think about that. It wasn't like today. How old were you, Brother Lee, when you enlisted in the military?
I was 17.
He was 17 years old. And there were a lot of men and women that 15, 16 years old that a lot because a lot of us never enlisted. And when these folks enlisted and they were put directly onto the front lines. Amen. It wasn't just going in, you know what, I'm going to advance my career. I'm going to get an education. No, these folks signed on the dotted line and they did that. And it just is really stunning to me when I think about that when they were storming the beach at Normandy, that there were a lot of 15 and 16 year olds that were standing on those boats, staring into the bunkers, the concrete bunkers that were housing machine guns. And that as they were coming off their boats, they could hear the sounds of the machine guns ricocheting off the boats, and they could literally see the bodies of their own patriots being shredded and being falling down, and still they stormed the beach. Now that really doesn't make a whole lot of sense. But you see, when the United States military was operating tactically, they were not operating tactically from a strategic standpoint. You know how they were operating? They were operating from a hope and a belief that what they were doing was the right thing. Amen? That's what enabled them to do it. That's what enabled all these men to storm the beach of Normandy, even though they were facing all these machine guns, and even though they were outnumbered in terms of gun, in terms of firepower, in terms of position. It doesn't make sense to do what they did militarily, but yet they did it. And that was the key turning point in the war that let the Germans know that America had come to win this war. I'm going to be ashamed. If people know that I'm going through this, I'm going to be ashamed. I don't want anybody to know what I'm going through. And that's exactly what the enemy wants, because that closed mouth will not get fed. Amen? If you don't tell the Lord that you're hungry, if you don't tell the Lord that you're, he's not going to force feed you. You understand what I'm saying? His table is full of food. The Lord's table is full of food. It is full of drink. It is full of everything that you need. But if you don't say that you're hungry, he's not going to invite you to the table. All the Lord wants you to say is that you're hungry. And as soon as you say that you're hungry, he's going to say, don't you see that seat? It has your name on it. I've been waiting for you to tell me that you're hungry. And there's your plate. That's your fork. That's your spoon. That's your cup. This is your place in our family, the righteous family of God. But I need you to communicate with me. Amen. And see, a lot of times we don't accomplish the things that we don't because our communication is lacking with the Lord. And our communication is lacking with each other too. Sometimes you got to learn how to trust your brother. Amen. Sometimes you got to learn how to believe in your brother. And sometimes we may struggle with that more than even trusting in the Lord. But a family that doesn't communicate is a family that can't accomplish much when everybody gets on the same page at the same time. When everybody stops worrying about what other people are going to think about them or what they're going to say about them, and we only focus on what is the task that God has called us to do, we will accomplish it. In Jesus' name, amen. But these 16, 17, 18-year-olds changed the world when they stormed the beach because they believed that they were doing the right thing. They went up and they said, you know what? I want to go to war because we're going to be destroying an enemy who is doing a bad thing. And I don't care if it may potentially cost my own life. I am willing to do it. Because you know, when the Lord calls us to be Christians, he's saying, I'm asking for your life. I'm asking you to sign on the dotted line. I'm asking you to sign in blood, the blood that Jesus Christ shed on Calvary. And that's how we're going to sign this contract. It is an eternal contract. It is not a 3-month contract. It is not a 4-month contract. It is not a 10-year contract. It is a contract that is eternal. It is a contract that will be recognized in the Lamb's Book of Life. When you confront your God in judgment, your name shall be written there as a testimony to the promise that you made to God, that you would serve him with every ounce of your body and every breath and until your heart beats the last beat, that I'm going to serve the Lord. Amen. That's the type of Christian we got to be. Because those are the Christians. Christians that make an impact. There is, you know, when all this stuff was going on and with Hurricane Harvey, you know, people were pointing to various ministries. Well, why are ministries doing this? And well, why are ministries doing that? And well, why are ministries doing this? And my only response is, then get involved with somebody who is doing something. Amen. Instead of taking all this airspace to voice all your opinions about what people weren't doing, then get out there and do it yourself and actually make a difference. Amen. Because when God puts it in your heart to go out there and make a difference, you are going to do it. Because hell will not prevail against us. Just like they stormed the beach of Normandy, we must also storm the beaches of our community, of our city. We must go out and reach them and bring them to the house of the Lord and not expect them to trickle in. We have to be the type of Christians that are willing to storm the beach and not worry about what the outcome is, because we can trust that the Lord is going to do what he says he can do. You see, Jesus asked them a very important question. He asked them two questions. He says, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And so they said, you know, some people say it's Isaiah, some people say it's Jeremiah, some people say it's John the Baptist or another of the prophets. But the Lord said, okay, well, that's what the people are saying. Well, what do you have to say? What do you have to say about who I am? And Peter responded to him, and he told him, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And what he responds to this, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by your Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. And what he's saying is that God will build his church on the backs of those people that believe that he is the Son of God. That is what God is going to do. God is going to build his church using those people that without doubt say that he is in fact the Son of God. And in that faith, that unyielding, unflinching faith that God, that Jesus is the Son of God, he will build his church. Who do you say that he is? I hope that you say that he is Christ, the resurrection. You know, that's always what I think about. That's something that always motivates me, is that I worship a resurrected God, not a dead God. Not some guy that came and went. Some guy that was here and was resurrected on the third day. And what was the resurrection to show? The resurrection was to show his children, if you believe in me, all things are possible. If you believe in me, if you trust in me, if you yield your life unto me, all things are possible. I have been resurrected from the grave. The greatest challenge is overcoming death. And if I have overcome death, that there is nothing that will ever stand in your way on this earth that can overcome the power of God to do the miraculous and to do the amazing. But you need somebody that believes. Amen. You can't do it. A dream becomes a goal once you get started. Amen. There's a lot of people that dream, but it's once you put that first step, you take that first action, that dream is no longer a dream. It then becomes a goal. And so sometimes when we're laboring in the service of the Lord, what we forget to do is to establish a goal. What do you want to do? How are you going to let your light shine? And how are you going to allow Christ to be the fuel that empowers you to do the things that no one thinks are possible? You know, we live in a world full of doubters, and it's great. You know, people get upset, and people say, well, the reason why I didn't accomplish this is because no one believes in me. I'm sorry. Amen. I'm sorry, but sometimes you're going to want to do things that people aren't going to believe in. We can't use that as an excuse. I'm waiting for someone to believe in me to do something. Because let me tell you something. You know who believes in you? The Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. He says, I have created you in my image. And I have created you for wondrous works. I have formed you while you were still in the womb. And I have set you on a purpose. And I believe in you. And though the whole world may not believe in me, and though everyone else may not believe in you, you know that the Lord Jesus Christ believes in you. And it is upon that rock that we shall build his kingdom. Amen. That which is immovable. That which cannot be broken. That which will never see corruption. That which is absolute perfection. That's what we're going to build on. That's what we're going to build on. You see, we can't be the foundation. Amen. Because we ain't perfect. But Christ is that perfect foundation. And as we construct on that perfect foundation, we will see victory. You know, when we're out there doing the work, it's one thing to give somebody something physically. You know, we gave people water. Some people needed water physically. But as you were giving unto them and you were talking to them, you saw what the real need is, right? The real need is the feeling of being delivered. Amen? People wanted to be delivered. And that's one of the things that Jesus is. He's a deliverer. One of the great functions of Christ in our life is to break chains that bind us, things that conspire us to stop us from achieving what God has in store for us, because that's what the enemy tries to do. The enemy is trying to stop us. When we were in our Bible study today, we were in Psalm 32, and David said, while I was silent, my bones wasted away. While I was silent, my bones wasted away. But he said that when I made that confession, I actually opened my life, opened my mouth, then the Lord was faithful and he was just and he was powerful enough to deliver me and to wrap me in his unfailing love. And sometimes when we are suffering, we sit there and we suffer in silence because we're in shame or anything else. And that's exactly what the enemy wants us to do. The enemy wants us to remain silent, because once we make that confession, once we make that call to our God, once we call upon our Father, he is faithful and he is just to answer what in our deepest need, in our darkest moment, the Lord will come through, and we cannot suffer in silence. We got to tell the Lord, Lord, come and rain down in my life. Lord, give me strength. Lord, give me direction. Lord, give me guidance. Lord, give me power. And I trust that you will do so. And when you do that, isn't it amazing how the Lord just infuses you with energy and power to go out there and accomplish it?